is the Charles M. Sappenfield Lecture this evening. And I think tonight we recognize the tradition of internationality that has been a real distinguishing part of our college here. Many of the students and certainly many of the faculty have benefited from the international perspective that resides here in our college. We're celebrating that distinction tonight by welcoming one of our own back after some time away on campus. Tom Kerwin, who is a senior project designer with Skidmore, Owings in Maryland and Chicago, is here tonight to talk about the practice of architecture in the Woollen community. Tom has been involved in projects around the world, Spain, England, America, Canada, and most recently the Philippines. I ask you to join me in greeting Tom Kerwin.
This evening is a very broad subject, the practice of architecture in the global community. A large portion of my time at SOM has been spent working on international projects. And I just returned from spending a year overseas in the Philippines working on the Rockwell Center project. Doing international work presents many challenges, some of which are very practical issues, and others which are less tangible. As anyone who's traveled abroad knows, being in another country can be difficult. Working abroad can present even greater challenges. Practical or tangible challenges may include environmental and climatic conditions, understanding the global economies and knowing where to find the work, dealing with local building codes and governing authorities, working in countries that have been closed to outsiders and now are opening their doors to foreign investment and tourism, dealing with the lack of public infrastructure such as roads, water supplies, and other utilities, also dealing with the lack of business infrastructure, being able to communicate and to get something as simple as a photocopy, or being able to communicate by phone. Interpreting the indigenous architecture and understanding its translation into what is usually a modern high-rise building type. The other set of challenges are much less tangible, and in my mind, can be much more difficult. These challenges include understanding the relationships between people of two different cultures. We, the American architects, and our foreign clients. Issues of time difference and physical separation from your client in doing business in their manner, yet physical contact with them being limited to monthly meetings. Challenges of dealing with people who may not like the fact that you're in their country, working in their country, such as perhaps some of the older professionals. Some examples of these, Asians are most accustomed to doing business face-to-face with handshakes. They recognize that the relationship, the business relationship, is of utmost importance. Yet, how do we as foreign architects build those relationships when we are so far away? And much of our contact must be either by fax or by telephone. How does one build trust long distance? My talk tonight is composed of three parts. First, I'd like to tell you a little bit about SOM, show you nine international projects, some of which are some of SOM's most significant recent works internationally. Second, I'd like to show you four projects that I've been involved with intimately, two of them being very international, and two of them being very local projects, Midwestern projects, actually. During the first two portions, I will speak more about the tangible challenges of working abroad. Third, I will speak about my experience in the Philippines, working on the Rockwell project. It is during this portion that I will speak more about the intangible challenges. So if I could have the lights. SON was founded in 1936 as a partnership by Louis Skidmore, Nathaniel Owings, and John Merrill. And we provide complete professional services in the fields of architecture, engineering, planning, and design. SON was remained a partnership, and currently has 35 partners. We're located in offices in Chicago, New York, San Francisco, Washington, D.C., Los Angeles, London, and Hong Kong. And as I show you the work of SON tonight, I will mention the partners who are responsible for each project. Two of the firm's most prominent works are Unfocused Weaver House on the left and Hancock Building on the right in Chicago. Weaver House, completed in 1958. Partner in charge of design was Gordon Bunshaft. And the Hancock Building, completed in 1970. Partner in charge of design was Bruce Grant. Under the direction of the partners, each project is undertaken by multidisciplinary teams that can aspire to and achieve greater quality and success than individuals working alone. This is a fundamental part of SON's mission statement, and it's key to its success in practicing internationally. More often than not, international projects are large in scale, and SON's resources are tapped to work on those projects. Large international projects are inherently complex. And adding to that complexity is the requirement for many different professional disciplines to complete a project. This is further complicated by a great physical distance between the project site and the professionals. SON is well suited to undertake those projects because we have a complete team of multidisciplinary professionals working together in our office. And we're usually able to establish a satellite office, which helps overcome the issues of physical distance. SON has completed projects all over the world. I attempted to choose projects which are both fairly recent, hopefully exploring some of the challenges that we faced while working internationally. This first project is the Ludgate Building in London. Partner in charge of design is Bruce Grant. And this is a good one to speak about as it relates to dealing with government officials in the country in which one is working. The project was originally conceived as three very modern glass and steel office buildings. And it was presented to the British authorities around the time when Prince Charles was very active in criticizing modern architecture. So as a result, the authorities dictated that the design be changed. They preferred the use of stone, more traditional use of stone. The three buildings are comprised in elevation here. This is the one on the right shows the original design, which is actually the far right in elevation. The next two buildings, as I said, were changed to stone. The compromise was reached. They allowed one of them to stay as a modern glass and steel building. They dictated that one of them be very traditional in character. Buff colored stone is the primary building material. And the last building, which is Ludgate 10, took place from somewhere in the middle. The authorities dictated that the building was stone, but what the designers did in this particular project was use the stone in a very modern way. The fins that you see are actually granite, and they're tied together. The stainless steel panels and they're hung from the top of the building. So from a distance, the building almost takes on a Gothic appearance. But up close, one recognizes it. It's a very modern use of materials. The next one I will show you is the National in charge of design is Gordon Munshaft. Managing partner is Gordon Woollen. This project is an example of appropriate responses to a regional environment. Site being in Saudi Arabia on the edge of the Red Sea, 3-acre plaza on the edge of the Red Sea. And the project is composed of a triangular 27-story office block and a 6-story circular garage. So the configuration of the site and the local climatic conditions generate conformance to the project. As you can see, the verticality of the bank tower is interrupted by these big courtyards. This is actually, there's one you see from this elevation, and there's two on the other side. So what's happened is that the office window is actually open into the courtyards, and therefore it limits the direct sunlight on the glazing. The primary material of the wall being a travertine cladding, a precast backup system. The next project is it's United Golf Bank. It's in Monterey. It's a 12-story, 100,000 square foot office building. My partner in charge of design is Adrian Smith. Managing partner is William Grigg. This is another case of a building being responsive to issues of climate, context, and solar orientation. The exterior wall is composed of a precast panel system, and the windows are deeply recessed into the wall, which blocks out the high midday sun. And then to block out the lower morning and evening, east and west sun, there are these green glass fins that occur in each window. It's still allowed to light in, but it blocks out some of the heat in it. It still maintains the transparency of the wall, so you still have the views out. The wall is an abstract interpretation of the traditional lattice sunscreens that you find in the region, which allows, again, the daylight in without the heat of the glare, and allows the views out without sacrificing privacy. So the exterior wall is an abstract interpretation of this element at a new scale. The next project this is Canary Wharf. It's in London. Partner in charge of design is Bruce Graham. Managing partner is Robert Dyer. This is an example of both a large-scale infrastructure project and opportunities that become available when a foreign country's economy is booming. The project is located about 2 miles west of the city of London on an area called the Isle of the Dogs, and it's formerly Docklands. And the land is envisioned and has become the new financial district for London, with a lot of international trading firms located here. It was conceived as a series of open spaces and buildings placed with an official road network. It's got about 20 parcels of land and buildings, which create a city on the wharf. SOM coordinated the consortium of design professionals, international planning design professionals. And the goal was to have collection of influences and attitudes towards design. So we actually did, I think, two of the buildings, or one of the buildings. I think we did this one. But the rest of them were all done by other firms. It was opened up to other firms, so that there was some variety. But the public infrastructure elements and the open spaces were all done by SOM to ensure consistency, to reinforce a sense of place. The development has about 10 million square feet of commercial space and about 80,000 square feet of trading floors. And as I was speaking of earlier, SOM is well suited to undertake these kind of projects, mainly because of the multidisciplinary nature of the firm, with all architects, engineers, planning, staff, in-house. We're able to tackle a large project like this in one place, and we can coordinate with each other. The proper coordination of all the disciplines is one of the major keys to success in a project like this because of its complexity. This next project is called Saigon South. The planning partner is John Crippen. This project represents international opportunities that which occur when politically closed countries open up their borders to foreign investment and tourism. These countries are often in great need of infrastructure. This is a 6,500-acre extension of Ho Chi Minh City, Vietnam, and will eventually accommodate a population of 1 million people. This is just a small portion on the left of the larger master plan on the right. The whole project revolves around existing network of rivers, canals, and waterways. And the idea behind the project is to use those waterways as open space elements. And this project is actually initiating a repair of that network of waterways and restoring the water quality. The development will have a broad range of infrastructure. We'll have places for people to work, to live, to cultural, educational, and recreation facilities as well. The next project is called the Hong Kong Convention Center. Partner in charge of design is Larry Owings. Managing partners that I'm making. This project is being done in conjunction with the Hong Kong firm of Woollen and Ewing, and it's an extension to the existing Hong Kong Convention Center, which is back here. And the only option, because Hong Kong is such a densely built place, the only option for it to grow is out into the bay. So this is a man-made island that was built to house this facility. This is a building type which we've done quite a lot of work in, and it's a building type that's going to really grow a lot in Asia. As their economy is growing, their needs for large gathering facilities will grow as well. So the site for the building is very prominent in the bay. And for this reason, it takes on a real sculptural quality with the amorphic roof forms that you see. Seem pretty well suited to the bay or the location of the water. The views from the site are very dramatic, so one of the big challenges was to organize the building to take advantage of those views. Exhibition spaces today are designed with no natural light. The exhibitors want to have full control of the light, so I don't know if you've been to the original McCormick place in Chicago, you've probably seen that they have these big black curtains that they put up and there's an exhibit, so you can't really see the way and it does a lot of light. So here the challenge was to organize the public spaces and the restaurant spaces around the perimeter of the building. And then the exhibition spaces are going to be tucked inside so that those spaces, the public spaces, are going to take advantage of the views and the natural light. This next project is the KAL Operations Center. Partner in charge of design is Joe Gonzalez. Managing partner is Jeff McCarthy. With their business rapidly expanding in Korea, Korean Air asked us to design a structure for them to unify their employees at Kimpo International Airport. And so it's a pretty unique structure. It's designed to house aircraft and also house their executive employees, the mechanics, the flight crews, and all the support staff. Two main program elements are 16,000 square meters of wide body aircraft aerospace, which is housed here, and 125,000 square meters of office space. And it's obviously a U-shaped plan. So to span the enormous hangar system, a new structure system was developed for the project. And there are two double arch columns. Steel trusses that span between three columns. Well, this is a kind of a unique solution because most hangars that you see are obviously the span is done across the doors. What this did is it takes the structure back and plan it back to here so the span is less. So therefore you reduce the amount of steel. You reduce the depth of the truss, so therefore you reduce the amount of steel. A lot of the buildings tonight, you probably see that show a nice synthesis between especially architectural and structural design. I think this project is a nice example of the two disciplines coming together. These are actually structural framing drawings, but the architecture is expressive of this as well, with the roof forms. We have to be expressed when we're going to this project. This next project is the Jim Mao building in Shanghai, China. Partner in charge of designers Adrian Smith, managing partners Tom Finston. This is currently under construction, and it's an example of at least an attempt to incorporate indigenous architectural forms into a high-rise building. This is always a tough thing to achieve. Taking a modern 20th century 88-story building and somehow making it Chinese. In this case, the pagoda serves as the inspiration for the form, with the skin gently stepping back in a rhythmic fashion up the building. You can form your own conclusions as to what is successful or not. It's located in the Pudong district in Shanghai, which is the new finance and trade zone. And it's going to have offices, hotel, retail, and parking. It's going to be about 1,400 feet tall with an articulated metal and glass skin. When this is done, it's under construction right now. When it's done in, I think, 1998, it's going to be the largest building in China, at least at that point. Largest building in China, actually. There are some other buildings scheduled to go up that will probably supersede it. But it should be quite dramatic in the city. The next building I want to show you is the Hajj Terminal at King Abdulaziz Airport, International Airport in Jeddah, Saudi Arabia. Partner in charge of design is Gordon Bunshaft. Managing partner is Gordon Woollen. Jeddah is located about 40 miles west of the holy city of Mecca. And since Jeddah is the closest large commercial city to Mecca, all air traffic bound for Mecca comes through Jeddah, Jeddah Airport, and then the remainder of the journey is done on the land. Once a year, large numbers of Muslim pilgrims from all over the world travel to Mecca to participate in the Hajj pilgrimage. This is a separate terminal facility designed just to handle those pilgrims. Roughly a 6-week period per year handles about 1 million pilgrims and about 5.5 million square feet. It's an open air terminal. And it's used by the pilgrims while they're awaiting their ground transportation, which will take them to Mecca. There are 210 Teflon-coated fiberglass roof units, 210 modules, which are long-span structures supported by steel cables and steel pylons. They have an oculus. Each one of them has an oculus to allow circulation of air. The material and the forms of the roofs are, first of all, the material, the Teflon-coated roof units allow a warm cast of light over the terminal, over the open air portion, most importantly with the use of heat gain. And then the form of the roofs, with the hole in the middle, the top, allows for circulation of the desert air. It may take as many as 18 hours for the pilgrims to make the necessary preparations for the Hajj. And in each of these modules, there are facilities for them to rest, to sleep, to wash, and to acquire food. This project is probably one of the strongest ones, and in my mind, one of the ones where all the disciplines come together. You have the people and their culture and their needs, they're served, and the climate is taken into consideration. And an integrated design solution is used and synthesizes architectural, structural, and environmental design. At this point, I want to show you some of the projects I've been involved with prior to the sale of the Philippines. The very first project that I was able to work on what I got to speak more was this one. It's called Exchange House. And it's the one that the partner in charge of design is Bruce Graham, managing partner's allocated. When I first began at Skidmore, the London economy and development was booming. And SL had two very large projects. One of them was Canary Wharf, which I showed you earlier. The other one was Bishopsgate, or Broadgate. And it's a project that consists of 14 buildings. This is one of the buildings called Exchange House. I think an important point to be made is that SLM often targets international projects in areas where the global economies are strong. And where there is obviously much building happening. We opened an office in London to properly serve the clients that we gained for Canary Wharf and for Broadgate. And subsequently, this office became like a full service office. As I said, Exchange House is one of 14 buildings to comprise Broadgate. This is Exchange House here. And it sits north. These are the train sheds. This whole project was built around Liverpool's new station. This is a historic train station in London. And the site for Exchange House particularly is located right over the tracks. This is the station, the tracks run in this fashion. And they run right underneath this building. Actually, right underneath this plaza. So the premise for the design of this building became a pure function of the site because of the tracks running underneath it. This building expands the tracks in the manner of a bridge. So there are four parabolic arches that rest on these concrete pylons, and then the tracks run underneath the building. This is actually the ground level, the plaza, which is completely column free. And then underneath that level is where all the tracks are. We studied a lot of structural alternatives, and this particular arch, the parabolic arch, was the most efficient. And one of the things that drove the expression of the building was that we really wanted to express these arches. Two of them were expressed externally, two of them were internal. So you can see kind of a look at it there. The office space is housed within the main block. And those support functions, such as the stairs and the toilet rooms and the fan rooms, are hung from the side of the building. Probably one of the most challenging aspects of this project was convincing the London Fire Brigade and the other code officials to really let us express the structure. The arches are not clad, are not fire protected in a traditional sense. They're painted built up steel sections. And the members which tie the arches back at key points into the floor system are coated with what is called intimacy paint, which had not been used in London at that time. It's a thick, spray-on, fire-protective coating, but it looks like paint, so therefore it can be exposed to the weather, it can be outside. And the glass is actually fire-rated as well. It's a fire-rated glass. It's actually an expensive glass, but the client felt it was worth the money, it was worth the time to do the studies. It allowed us to work with the code officials to prove to them that this was a safe thing to do. So by taking all those steps, and probably the biggest key was setting the glass back from the arch itself, from the main structure by 5 feet, 1.5 meters. And those things combined, we were able to convince them that this was a safe thing to do. Next project is it's called Villa Olympica, and it's in Spain, Barcelona. Partner in charge of design again was Bruce Graham. Managing partner was Jeff McCarthy. The next opportunity after London I was in Spain in preparation for the 92 Summer Olympics. The master plan for the sailing programs and the regatta programs was intended to bring Barcelona closer to the sea. So this, we were hired to do this project, which is located on the sea. It's a 109,000 square meter multi-use complex. It has a Ritz-Carlton hotel, it has office space, residential condominiums, and a large retail portion where Barcelona is the sea. We worked in conjunction with Frank Gehry on this project. We were responsible for the master plan of the tower, including the retail portion for the project, and we chose this project to build one of his signature fish sculptures, and along with some of his other moves, creating some interesting challenges for our engineers. This project was a continuation of Bruce Graham's desire to really express the structure of the building. And so this building presented a lot of the same, almost the identical same challenges that the Exchange House presented. Although they were made much easier by the precedent, by the research that we've done for Exchange House. The steel structure was again pulled away from the wall. And it's simply painted. It's simply, the frame is not hard. And the glass and the metal panel system of the wall is actually rendered in blue and gray, so the white painted structural frame is really enhanced against that wall. The next project I want to show you is called the Rice Children's Center. And the partner in charge of design is Joseph Gonzalez, and the partner in charge of design. This is not a very global project, so I'm going to diverge for a couple projects actually. This project is in Lansing, Illinois. It's about a half hour's drive from our office. And the big question is, where was the next building built at the time of this building? Well, there wasn't one anywhere in the world. We decreased in size quite dramatically. If there was one, we didn't know about it. Anyway, both the US and European economies were into a pretty deep recession about the time this building was going into Mediterranean. So therefore, I'm going to diverge for the next two projects. Fortunately for me, during this time, I was able to work on this project. It's a project type that Esalen rarely has the opportunity to do. It's very small scale. At the Rice Children's Center, an organization called the Children's Home Aid Society of Illinois provides therapeutic treatment for children with mental health and social problems. Kids that come to stay here without otherwise surviving than people who are in their own home. They call upon professionals in social work and psychiatry to give them treatment before they stay here. It's a very simple building in a lot of ways. It's basic construction. It's a concrete frame, a block back on the brick there. The city that was still there. And a lot to say about the building form, because it's sited in a primarily residential neighborhood. The building has three primary functions. It's first a home for the children. The children live in these wings. They're organized around a separate dining hall. It has a school, which has the gymnasium of the school, and has an administrative room. The main idea driving the design was to make the place feel like home. So we tried to break down the scale of the building with various residential forms. And the primary functions wrap around this courtyard, which is a view from within the courtyard, which is where the children play. And we try to introduce playful elements. This is a green glazed brick clock tower with a blue metal roof, and this is actually the dining hall. It's blue metal roof. This is some artwork that actually the kids have done. And we have transposed onto these tiles that are above the entries. So this is a fun project to work on. The next one is also another U.S. project. It's the Sioux City Art Center. And it's part of the charge of design is Joe Gonzalez, managing partner of Ottawa City. It's located in the CBD of wonderful downtown Sioux City. It's envisioned as a new cultural center for downtown. It's 45,000 square feet, and when it's completed, the material will house existing buildings in the regional art of the Upper Midwest. It will also serve as a facility for art education and music performance and social gatherings. The building is located at the southern gateway to downtown, so these are the views of the building you can get. And anyone entering Sioux City and the main expressway leads to the south of the building, even coming off the expressway and see the building from the views. This building is also composed of $3 million. This is actually a very early elevation study, but it's kind of a nice diagram growing. The central atrium is the first element. That's a three-story volume which would serve as the main hub of the gathering space. And then there's a stair that wraps around it like that. This is kind of lettered in yellow. This is an open stair which is in the atrium and leads you up into the second or third floor where the galleries and classrooms are. The second major element is it's an L in plan, but it's a brick clad three-story volume which has the galleries and the classrooms and the administrative space. And then the third major piece are these smaller brick structures that wrap around the front and bring the scale of the building down to the sculpture room. And that those house the auditorium or the cafe, the retail space. Within the L, the galleries are located on the third floor. So there's no windows. There are no windows up there. There are light wells that occur every 20 feet, which allow indirect lighting to the galleries. It's a pretty simple, raw space. It's just an exposed concrete ceiling and wood floors. And then those bays are expressed on the outside with these inset vertical panels. And then the ribbon windows that wrap around the building at the second level, which that's where the classrooms and the administrative space are. So there's a lot of lighting to those spaces. The building's almost done. This is taken in August from actually the north side. It's the drum and the stair are clad in an insulated glazing unit, which has a low light of solar, so low light of a frame of glass, which is a pattern that's translucent and will allow natural light into the atrium, again, with reducing heat gain. Again, this is not an international project, but it's something that the project that I'm very excited about. It's going to really be open ceremony in about a month or so. So more keeping with the topic, I'd like to share with you some of my experiences in the Philippines. The Philippines are, in a lot of ways, a wild place. They're very diverse, as these two sides represent. On the one hand, you have Manila on the left, which is a very difficult place to live. It's a very crowded, congested, poverty-ridden city. But once you get out of Manila, as on the side on the right, it's an island called Baraka, which is unbelievably beautiful. It's mostly vegetated and one of the most delightful landscapes in the world. It's like paradise. The obvious common thread throughout the country is the wonderful people. And it's the people and the culture which produce probably the most interesting challenges when working in the country. The one word which I heard most while working in Manila was the word relationship. The relationship is of foremost importance, and it applies to all aspects of Filipino life and business, including the practice of architecture. Manila has a tight-knit business community, and its members are as much friends as they are business associates. This idea of a business community founded on close friendships is very wonderful in many ways, but it can also be frustrating for a foreigner. A foreigner is not always trusting me, right? He's sometimes not always warm. Some Filipino architects and engineers are not altogether happy with the influx of foreign professionals into their country. Now that the economy is strong and the building industry is booming, they feel that their time has come to reap the benefits of their great nationalistic. Fortunately, not often in the engineers' point of view. Then they recognize that there are more forward-looking architects and engineers who recognize that they can learn a lot about technologies and methods that they've not been previously exposed to. Working with those professionals can become very rewarding. Another frustrating fact of life about doing business in Manila is the pace of business. Everything takes an extraordinary amount of time. On our initial visits to Manila, we would fly thousands of miles to see our client, and they did not have the same sense of urgency that we have. Meetings can become sometimes social occasions as much as business. And we look at our watches and wonder if we ever get anywhere. There probably wasn't a healthier attitude towards time, but just the same, we're trying to move the project along. A lot of these factors were the reason, the driving force for my going to the Manila. This client and the project were important to us, and it became evident that we needed someone right there to serve them, a satellite office, which we sometimes do. I worked in their office every day and met with them every day. SOM Chicago and I were contacted either by fax or email or phone, or most of the time by a couple of those ways. And that became the link to the client, and it helped to better establish something that took some time to achieve, but something that we recognize as essential at the beginning, and that is the relationship. The project we were working on is called Rockwell Center. Partner in charge of design is Larry Owings. Managing partner is Alan Engel. It's a previously industrial site, which I guess is obvious, but it's on the edge of the financial district in Manila, which is called Makati. And it's also located along the Pasig River, which we try to make out here. The site is owned by a company called Morocco. And Morocco is the primary electric service provider in the Philippines, and it's owned by the Lopez family. So this large structure, is a former electricity-generating power plant that's now out of commission. And there are a lot of fuel oil tanks that are still left on the site. This slide, although it's very difficult to make out, I think you can see the power plant here, and that's Makati. And obviously that's the possibility. Again, this is, sorry for the size, difficult to make out, but that's the edge of Makati kind of building up to the site. Eventually that will all fill in and kind of blend together when this project is done. These two slides. These slides are both taken in Makati, which is, so these are very close. I mean, this is the Pasig River, and this is the Center Business District. And you can see there's quite a separation between, there's a vast separation of wealth between the people in Philippines and these slides kind of represent that effort. The river is not a pretty sight right now, but there's an attempt being made to clean up the river, and projects such as Rockwell can help subject by recognizing the river, recognizing that there can be an amenity, not turning our backs to it, but by addressing it. And a lot of Filipinos point to Singapore as an example of kind of the success of turning a once polluted waterway into an amenity. These slides are taken in the old walled city of Manila called Intramuros. And the building on the right in particular is a nice example of some of the architecture left by the Spanish who occupied the Philippines for several centuries. The base of the building was a stone called adobe stone, which is actually the rock that you find all over the hills, the basis when you're excavating, it's the basis of the ground. And then the upper level was clad in wood called Nara. These are two indigenous materials which are used in the Philippines. So rock woven is a multi-use development consisting of office, hotel, retail, residential buildings. And one of the first opportunities we recognized in visiting the site, believe it or not, was to reuse this building. There's a big retail component in the project, and there was this big crane bay. I don't know how many slides of it, but there was this big crane bay that runs the length of the building. And it seemed natural that that would serve as the atrium space for a retail building. So the power plant, it's organized on the site as such. It just seemed like a great place for that building to sit and be a retail building, because it's a central place in the project, and it seemed natural for it to serve as a central gathering place and organizing building. Another driving idea behind the master plan was the desire to provide large amounts of open space within the development. Makati is very densely built, and there's a definite lack of open space relief. So our client felt pretty strongly about providing park space for the market. These factors, coupled with the desire to achieve a certain density for financial reasons, led us to develop a series of towers for the project. The towers are organized around in kind of a C fashion, around two major parks, which will occur here, and which kind of occur here, it's kind of blocked by this building. And then two major entry parks, one here and one here, with a connection to the river. And hopefully with the commitment to upgrade the riverbank and landscape it. These slides show a more detailed development of phase one, which is the side west of the retail building. This is the place where the retail building will occupy. The project has a 50-story office building, which we call Locus Tower, and hopefully will serve as a landmark for the development, but also a landmark in Ada. The remainder of the buildings are high-end residential condominium buildings. And each building takes on an individualized shape so that they're recognizable from the complex. And the towers are spaced widely apart so that the views can be taken advantage of the surroundings. The project is composed of buildings of two different scales. Obviously, you have the towers, but what we attempted to do was introduce these smaller 3- and 4-story bustle buildings, which actually attach to the tower, which are actually became the highest end residential units. And they hopefully bring the scale of the project, which is quite large, obviously. These buildings are a 40-story tower, and this one is a 46-story tower. Hopefully, these will will help to bring the scale of the project along with the club located here to the garden space. And this is where, this particular project, this is where we're hoping to really use the natural Filipino materials, the adobe soil and the lawn, and obviously the natural vegetation, so that it is Filipino here. The side on the left is the side on the right. This is the top, this is the tallest residential building. It's called the Zal Tower. And this is actually the foreman's building. It's interesting how it came about. These two buildings actually started as two cylinders, almost like Marriott Towers in Chicago, two cylinder buildings. And we have a feng shui consultant on the project. Feng shui is, I don't know how best to describe it, but it's beliefs about symbolism and things in the culture. And the Chinese and the Filipino have their own feng shui. But the feng shui expert thought that these two buildings, as cylinders being the same height, looked like two candles. It looked like they would be on a gravesite. So obviously that was a no. He allowed us to keep one of the cylinders at one point. And when he said, why not make it an oval in play? Oval symbolizes fertility. Right? So you love that form. The building just became an extreme egg in the plan, actually. And it has four units. We're dividing it into the parts of the egg. This one, if I can have the lights on, please. To conclude, as you can see, there are many opportunities for doing work everywhere in the world. I've shown you some projects tonight that were in England, the Philippine Islands, Hong Kong, China, Saudi Arabia, Spain, Korea, and Vietnam. It's now more important than ever for a firm such as SLM to reach out into the global community for opportunities, especially when you consider that there's not a whole lot happening in the US right now. Most major American cities went through a huge building boom in the 80s, and the markets are saturated, especially with respect to office space. We have attempted and been successful in getting projects in the civic sector, such as the Art Center I showed you and the Children's Center. We're also doing the renovations of the Lyric Opera in Chicago, and also the Chicago Symphony Orchestra in Michigan Avenue. But the bulk of our work right now is overseas, and we're almost always in Asia. It'll be interesting to see what opportunities the future holds, what part of the world will we end up next. Some say that South America will be the next place. We've been watching that part of the world pretty closely. Another place that people speak of is India. So we shall see where we end up next. The last question I have for you is, does any of this sound interesting? I mentioned in the beginning that I do have another reason for being here, and that's to hopefully spark your interest in perhaps beginning your career at SLM. I'd like to extend an invitation to you all to come visit the firm. There have been quite a few Ball State students at SLM who have done very well. There's one who's done particularly well, Craig Hartman, who's a design partner in the San Francisco office, which many of you may know of. We also have, I think, we're trying to figure out tonight, we have five Ball State students in the Chicago office as well. It's definitely not for everybody, and some of you may have interests that are not particularly suited to SLM, but if you are interested, I've left applications with Marvin, and we have a summer intern program as well, which you can keep in mind. We take on a limited number of graduates from several schools each year, and it would be nice to maintain a relationship between SLM and Ball State in the future. I think that coming back here tonight, I realize that even more so, the quality of education here is really outstanding. The professors, the dedicated professors we have here, we're here when I was here, they were here before that, have really kind of held the fabric of the school together. It's really quite amazing. So, thanks again for allowing me to speak with you this evening. I enjoyed it. And I'll be happy to stay around the front if you have any questions, but otherwise, thanks and good night.